so excited that you're here. Can everyone in the back hear me? All right? Yeah? Good. Okay. I'm Margot Flood, and I'm the Executive Director of the Environmental Leadership Center here on campus and the college's sustainability official. And I welcome you on behalf of our President, Sandy Pfeiffer, who was called out of town and is so sorry that he cannot be here tonight to introduce one of our own to you. We're honored tonight to present author and Warren Wilson Professor Mallory McDuff as the evening's first 2011 sustainability speaker. Mallory will be followed on February 24th at 7 p.m. here in the chapel by coal historian Jeff Biggers. His talk is free and open to the public, and we hope that you will come back on the 24th and join us for that. So I welcome you now. I see old friends, I welcome you, and new friends. We have faculty, staff, and students here, and in case you want to know more about the college quickly, at the end of the presentation, would faculty, students, staff, raise your hands? Let folks know who you are. Great, thank you. It's gratifying for all of us to be joined by so many of you who are representatives of faith communities here in town. Would you raise your hand so we know who you are? Great, thank you. I'm tempted to have some form of the peace now so we can all turn around and meet each other, but I think we'll wait until later for that. And I do hope you'll engage in that at the end of this talk. So I have some thanks first. And first I want to thank Julie Lehman, who's our Director of Church and Interfaith Relations, for bringing together this community of people together tonight. She has joined so many communities connected in this one event. It's really great. I want to thank Steve Runholt, who can't be with us tonight, and the Warren Wilson Church for co-sponsoring this talk. I want to thank Advantage Green for being a sponsor of our sustainability series. Environmental Leadership Center staff members Philip Gibson and Ellen Quarren, and our great student crew for managing the sustainability speaker series this year. I want to thank our faculty advisor, Laura Lennick, who is the faculty connection for our sustainability speaker series. She's a sustainable agriculture professor on campus and the director, faculty director of sustainability education. I want to thank all of you for joining in the conversation. You make this robust. I also would like to introduce the evening's topic by sharing this Cherokee story with you. Some of you have heard me tell this before. It goes like this. One evening, an old Cherokee told his grandson about a battle that goes on inside people. He said, "My son, the battle is between two wolves inside us all. One is evil. It is anger, envy, jealousy, sorrow, regret, greed, arrogance, self-pity, guilt, resentment, inferiority, lies, false pride, superiority, and ego. The other is good. It is joy, peace, love, hope, serenity, humility, kindness, benevolence, empathy, generosity, truth, compassion, and faith." The grandson thought about it for a minute, and then he asked his grandfather, "Which wolf wins?" The old Cherokee simply replied, "The one you feed." So we are here to feed together tonight on what we think is good. In 2010, a Pew report on religion in America did a comprehensive poll, and it revealed that 16.1% of Americans claim they are unaffiliated with any religion. That means 83.9% of Americans claim they are affiliated with a particular religion. I find that a tremendous reason for hope. And I'd like to share a quote here about Mallory McDuff's book from the Reverend Sally Bingham, who's president and founder of Interfaith Power and Light. She says, "The action needed to protect the environment and provide a sustainable future will not happen without the moral voice that religion brings to the dialogue. This is an important book for understanding the role that religion will and must play in healing this wounded creation." So I go back to the statistic for the hope, and I say, for the 83.9% of us who claim we are affiliated with a religion, we know this moral voice. How do the words of our faith speak in our act to our actions with regard to all of creation? And so I learned from Mallory and how Mallory did this book, and through Mallory's book, and I learned many things. Her journey with her daughters to learn about how communities of faith translate values into action serves as a challenge to all of us. How do we make the words real? What can we do? So, Mallory McDuff has taught in the Environmental Studies and Outdoor Leadership Department at Warren Wilson College for 11 years. She lives here on campus with her two daughters, co-researchers, Maya, age 11, and Annie Sky, age 5. Her children joined her for much of the research for Natural Saints. In addition to Natural Saints, she is the co-author of the book Conservation Education and Outreach Techniques, published by Oxford University Press, as well as articles in academic journals and op-eds in places like USA Today and the Huffington Post. Mallory is a longtime Episcopalian. She worships at the Cathedral of All Souls in town. She has a PhD in wildlife ecology and conservation with a focus on environmental education. Please join me in welcoming Mallory.
About Natural Saints here at Warren Wilson, where so many people helped to shape the book. There's a high probability that someone on your pew read a chapter and gave some feedback, and I revised accordingly and resubmitted it to them. I have to tell you, too, that students who read drafts of these chapters especially enjoy finding errors in the text. I've never had students read a text so closely and with such attention to detail that no one missed the reading. This book captures stories that involve the love of God, people, and places, from Western North Carolina to Newark, New Jersey. When you walked into the chapel, you saw prayer flags created by students. Each flag features the name of a place, a sacred place. And then tonight, almost 90 faith leaders gathered for dinner, for an interfaith dinner. And they created their own prayer flags, naming a sacred space. I invite you to look at those prayer flags as you leave the chapel. I want to thank the Environmental Leadership Center, especially for organizing this talk and asking a local to participate, since so many faculty and staff and students here are doing such good work about sustainability. It's also fitting that this topic of faith and sustainability comes after one of our talks by Bill McKibben, who packed the house, if anyone was here for that talk. He's a climate activist, as you know, and a Sunday school teacher. And if any of you work here, you might remember there were three questions asked of Bill. We had time for three questions. Does anybody remember what the last question was about? It was about faith and the environment. Somebody asked, what's the role of faith communities in the climate crisis? And I feel like tonight we get a chance to expand on that response and tell stories and strategies of what people of faith are doing to save God's earth. For this research, I traveled to 8 different geographic regions of the United States, visiting 50 different congregations. And as Margaret said, often with my daughters Maya and Annie Sky in tow. It was funny because I told the story that my children began to describe congregations by the quality of the snacks at coffee hour. That was their metric. And it really was for me, it was became a personal journey, not just a research project. For this book, many of the stories in the book explore an interfaith component. But I chose to focus on Christian communities because I wanted to explore my own faith tradition. What did I bring to this? The book highlights 8 ministries and shows how churches have been integrating the environment into traditional ministries, from feeding the hungry to creating sacred spaces, protecting human dignity, promoting justice. You saw images and quotes from the stories as you walked into the chapel. The interesting thing is that often people talk about greening institutions. And what I found in my personal journey, in my research journey, was that greening most often happened when congregations integrated the environment into traditional ministries, into work of congregations. One particular story, I spent about a week in South Florida, and their congregations were supporting the Coalition of Immokalee Workers and their fight for fair wages for immigrant farm workers and an end to modern-day slavery in the fields. In addition to organizing protests against fast food companies, congregations were doing this. They were making food. They were housing farm workers during rallies. They were saying prayers before rallies. Good old Christian hospitality. And this was work that came naturally. And the interesting thing for one man that I interviewed, he said, his name is Tom O'Brien, his knees were amputated, his legs were amputated at his knees. And he said, this is the first time that I've seen my work in the church actually make a difference, besides tithing. My daughter was interviewed for 103.5, well, I was interviewed too, but the highlight of the show was my daughter's talking. And somebody asked, the interviewer asked, you know, what surprised you from this journey? And the 11-year-old said, what surprised me was, I thought you just went to church and then you went home before doing this work. But I really saw that churches could work together to make a difference. And I was sitting there like, wow, you really got that? That's great. Never told me that. But that really was one of the take-home messages. One of the other places I traveled was Seattle, Washington, where the organization Earth Ministry, a tremendous resource for congregations, is training people of faith in environmental advocacy. Executive Director Leanne Barris says, 1,000 acts of Christian kindness can be wiped away by a single act of Congress. That's sobering. That's one of her sound bites. It's one you can't forget. But to that end, Earth Ministry is training congregations, giving them skills to do environmental advocacy, and they're partnering with environmental groups. So they're one of the coalition, the Environmental Priorities Coalition. And with the lack of momentum for climate legislation at the national level, the state of Washington, through this Environmental Priorities Coalition, is actually going to introduce a bill for coal-free Washington. That's tremendous work. And it's been amazing to watch the respect of the environmental groups who never thought that, let's be frank, a religious group could get something done quickly. And this has been a tremendous shift in the political landscape of the state of Washington. It's been wonderful work. The key thing with this work, though, and it's so important to remember, that these actions transcend political boundaries. These acts are transforming people and places, as well as the entire conversation about faith and the environment in this country. Pastor Carol Jenkins at St. John United Lutheran Church in Seattle told me, this church, my church, our church, would be dead if we weren't doing environmental work. This is what people care about. So it's an issue of the relevance of churches to people today, and especially to young people. For me, one of the most powerful lessons of this work was in the power of discernment, this very tricky D word. For my students, many of whom I appreciate are here tonight, they know this, that I tend to be a planner. Like, if things are in boxes and grids, I feel much more comfortable with the world. If my floors are clean, I feel content. But we live this time where we think we can anticipate and plan for so much. Just last week, for example, I forgot my best friend from high school's birthday. I just wasn't thinking about it. And at 10 o'clock at night, Facebook reminded me. So I got to post, put posts on her wall, and suddenly I was totally organized. I felt on top of it. But the reality is that part of a religious identity is opening yourself up to prayers when you don't have a plan, when we may not actually have a plan, when there are no immediate answers. Stan Hubbard, the director of Canuga conferences just right out here in Hendersonville, an Episcopal Conference Center, told me, treat greening as discernment, not as a project. This isn't about hope being the strategy, he said. This is about being quiet enough to listen to opportunities that may arise. Stan's staff wanted to build a solar hot water heating system, and they started with a small project, but they really wanted to expand it to the whole conference center. But they couldn't figure out the financial incentives given their nonprofit status. After 2 years of searching and talking, the way Stan tells it, and he tells the story often, like every party that he attended, he talked about solar hot water heating systems. And ultimately, he had a conversation with Brownie Newman, a Warren alum who's here tonight. Brownie works now with FLS Energy. He's also our city council in Asheville. The result of those conversations was a solar hot water heating system that will save Canoe Conferences $700,000 in 30 years. Get the statistics straight. $700,000 in 30 years by heating water through the energy of the sun. Other institutions such as Mars Hill have collaborated with FLS Energy. Maybe Warren Wilson will be the next. The key is that environmental campaigns need time for planning actions, but we also need time for reflection and discernment and prayer. Tonight I'm going to begin by reading an excerpt from the introduction of the book, and then I'll read pieces from two stories, one in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, and one here in Western North Carolina. Between the two stories, I'll share a few images, that some of which includes our students, and then I'll conclude with a brief reading from the conclusion and some final reflections about how the book's been received out of the world. I thought you'd just write a book, but then I found out you have to, like, talk about it, write about it so people read it. So I want to share with you, too, just some of those lessons that I've had just in the past 6 months. But we'll have time for questions at the end as well. So as my students know, that's the agenda for today, because I always post a plan. But I'd like to start out by reading an introduction. The introduction is entitled The Doxology and the Communion of Saints. And at my last reading, a few people who are here were at this reading at Malacross, and I started singing some of the words, so just don't worry if I do. We're in a sacred place. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. My family always sang the doxology as a blessing in sacred gatherings. My grandfather, an Episcopal priest, would ask everyone to gather hands in a circle around the Thanksgiving supper table. Larry, he would say to my father in his deep southern drawl, unique to the Mississippi Delta, would you lead us in singing the doxology? With my grandfather's accent, two-syllable words became three, and a simple request became an invocation. In response, my father would sing the word praise in his gentle baritone that led our church choir, and we children would follow the words we knew by heart. We sang the doxology in dining rooms and hospital rooms, amid giggles of children at play and tears at the death of our own parents. As an adult, I feel the accumulated power of the words from the hymns, the Book of Common Prayer, and Bible verses repeated week after week, year after year, in Episcopal churches throughout the South. All those years, my prayers were praising God and all creatures here below, but this connection between faith and the environment wasn't obvious to me until my 40s. While my parents preached conservation through their actions, the words of my faith mirrored our family's then radical acts in the small town of Fairhope, Alabama, where we gave up trash services for Lent one year. No other family in our town called the waste management company on Mardi Gras to cancel their trash pickup services for 40 days. And this was before the days of recycling. Did my parents consider that conservation ethic inherent in both their Lenten discipline and the liturgy, such as the prayers of the people, for the good earth which God has given us, and for the wisdom and will to conserve it, let us pray to the Lord? I think they did, but for them, the connection wasn't intellectual or abstract. In her book, Leaving Church, Barbara Brown Taylor writes, "Living in relationship with creation is saving my life now." To my parents, the relationships among God, their faith in the earth, became their life. Faith, not politics, informed their Christian conservation ethic. We didn't say the word environment or conservation. But to conserve energy, we try not to use the air conditioner in the Alabama summer or central heat in the winter. My parents, who died before their time, lived in a communion of natural saints, creating spiritual community through Christian stewardship of the earth. This book aims to document the life of the church that my children will see as relevant to their spiritual and their ecological communities. The research reveals the stories of Christians using their faith as a moral mandate for saving the environment. Their journey also allowed me to reclaim my Christian identity in the progressive town of Asheville, North Carolina, where the word Christian sometimes evokes images of televangelists. Before beginning this book, I faced a room of 30 people gathered for a workshop on greener congregations. The church is where we go to be our best selves, said one participant. If we're trying to be better stewards of the earth, isn't church the place to start? This journey revealed many different versions of a compelling story, the story of churches weaving love of the Lord into care for the environment. The research also allowed me to bear witness to one of my grandmother's favorite hymns. This is taking a risk. Feel free to join in. I sing a song of the saints of God, patient and brave and true, who toiled and fought and lived and died for the Lord. They loved and knew, you know the words, some of you. And one was a doctor, and one was a queen, and one was a shepherd, and on the green. They were all the saints of God, and I need God helping to be one too. These natural saints are among us all. Ultimately, this work must happen in our home parishes, our own churches. After a summer of visiting churches, my then 2-year-old became adept at pointing out churches as we drove. That's a red church, she would say. That's a brown church. At the end of the summer, she exclaimed, I want to go to our church. Indeed, our stewardship of God's good earth starts at home with the natural saints among us. So I'm going to shift from the introduction to read from two stories and share with you some images. But I first want to share with you how I found these stories. This was not a random selection of religious environmental projects across the United States. This was me, one little person in Asheville, North Carolina, trying to connect the dots of folks who were doing good work around the country. So to select sites, I solicited names from religious leaders, from environmental religious leaders, religious environmental leaders, of folks and stories that they thought were doing good work. And then I had to be actually just realistic and say, what can I make fit? I'm working full-time, I have two kids. How can I make this work? The following story that I'm going to share with you is from Milwaukee, Wisconsin. And I found this story through the National Council of Churches Eco-Justice Program, which is another wonderful resource. And I chose this story to share with you today also because it talks about food. And food is the focus of this story. And a lot of my students are interested in food. And so I really had students in mind when I chose this chapter. So I'm just going to read a short excerpt and then share some images. This chapter, the ministry in this chapter, is feeding the hungry, gardening for God's children. After services at All People's Church in the Ramby neighborhood of Milwaukee, Wisconsin, parishioners headed to the back of the sanctuary to pick up radishes, basil, green onions, parsley, and other vegetables grown in the church garden. The back of the church functioned like a farmer's market, but the food grown by youth in the church was free. Pastor Steve Derby believes in the central role of food in the ministry of Jesus. In the big picture, God uses food to connect with the people, just like manna in the wilderness and the garden in Genesis. Each Sunday in congregations across the country, the church feeds people, holy food for holy people. In a symbolic act, the sacrament of communion elevates feeding to a spiritual encounter. Priests and pastors repeat these words, "This is my body that was given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." The Eucharist is the most common ritual in Christian churches, and grace before mealtimes remains the most common prayer in the world. For many children in the United States, the first prayer they learn is the classic, "God is great, God is good, let us thank him for our food." In the end, as in the beginning, God and food are bound together. Pastor Steve Jerby often said, 10,000 meals in the love of Jesus. He told me, food has become a theme for us. Our youth ministry, women's ministry, couples ministry, they all gather around a meal. In the central role of feeding as ministry, All People serves about 10,000 meals, including communion meals each year. The offerings include Sunday breakfast, a Wednesday community lunch, a Bible study, a Wednesday night meal, and a food pantry on Wednesday afternoons. In inner-city neighborhoods such as this one, access to fresh food is limited and often non-existent, while there's abundance of fast food. The health issues facing this community are fast and deeply connected to the available food, Pastor Steve said. So feeding becomes a health issue, a youth empowerment issue, a body image issue, and an economic issue in the Harambee neighborhood. Healthy food is a right. In downtown Milwaukee, several blocks from the Riverwalk, visitors can find an expansive garden, grocery store, with fresh vegetables and luxury like raspberries, Perrier, and sushi. But across the bridge in the Harambee neighborhood, when I biked there from downtown, the nearest food source I saw was a church's fried chicken, not a grocery store. To promote more fresh food, the church joined a CSA, a community-supported agriculture program, and the local co-op, funded by an Evangelical Lutheran Church of America grant. The food from the CSA is delivered on Tuesday and provides fresh, local food to use in the Wednesday feeding ministry. The church also hired Carolyn Jewett to work as a minister of meals, working 20 hours a week. Each summer, the food from the garden is harvested by youth in a Kids Working to Succeed program for their families who receive the food, as well as for Sunday mornings for members of the congregation. There's a whole lot of kingdom work going on here, said Pastor Steve. He also noted that while the church took steps, such as installing energy-efficient windows, they didn't see the congregation as an environmental model. 70% of our church wouldn't say we're an environmental church, he said. They might call us a feeding church or a justice church. We still serve food on styrofoam plates sometimes, he admitted. All People's Church integrated the environment into feeding and meals, a ministry that made sense for the mission of this church. To this end, the church received recognition for its Fresh Food for All ministry from the National Council of Churches, the Lutheran Church, and the National Religious Partnership for the Environment. So, After spending time there, it really, the interesting thing for me was just seeing this mantra of healthy food is a right lived out in a congregation. We're going to advance to the next slide. Okay, so now we can. So one of the interesting things for me when I got to this church was the back of the sanctuary really was, there's food in the church, like dirt in the church. That was, for my Episcopalian sensibilities, that was just a real shocker, to say the least. But as I reflected on it, I thought, well, my gosh, this makes total sense. I mean, I've been eating in the church since I was a little, well, since I was 13. And so it was so amazing to me to see a congregation, a sanctuary, actually become a place for feeding, for healthy feeding. This church took over an abandoned, vacant lot in inner city Milwaukee, the surrounding neighborhood, and started cultivating food. The Kids Working to Succeed program, through grant money, paid children $10 a day to work in the garden and attend, it's really a life skills program. They hired teenagers to be leaders in this program. So it was, I mean, one the day I was there, they were going to the bank to learn about keeping a bank account, et cetera. And they had all these agreements with families so that families knew this money was really the children's money. This was a very impoverished area in Milwaukee. I'm probably doing something wrong than I was earlier. Carolyn Jewett, the minister of meals, ran this food pantry. And I think I want to be really clear to say this wasn't like Organic City. When I got there to volunteer, the first thing Carolyn said to me was, you need to bag up these frozen chimichangas. So the reality was that, as many of you who have volunteered with food pantries know, the type of food that's most often given to people that need is the lowest quality of food. So this place, All People's Church, was making inroads. They were starting small, and next to the frozen chimichangas was fresh vegetables from the garden. And just, I think we can get so overwhelmed, like, oh my gosh, we can't like have everybody eating fresh vegetables every day because it's so overwhelming. But this, they were making a start. And to me, that was so powerful. And it had transformed, honestly transformed that church. And their central theme really was feeding. This is gonna work. It did work. Ooh, it worked so hard. So that last slide, it was so fun for me to get to spend time with the youth in the church. David Stevens, who worked in the garden with the Kids Working to Succeed program, was also a drummer for the church. So he was, I mean, they were rocking out. It was such a fun service. And so he was a drummer, and he told me, I work for God, I drum for God, and I work in God's garden. And he was so proud of that impact. I think for us at Warren Wilson, it's important for us to know that we have alums, so many alums working in the arena of food issues and food security. But I don't know if we know that, or broadcast the fact, we have a lot of people who are working in faith-based gardening programs. Nathan Valentine, a student who just recently graduated. Megan Corbett is working in a faith-based gardening program. This is a strong connection we can help students make, because congregations have land. They have people. There are certainly constraints, but they are institutions interested in feeding, inherently interested in feeding. So I really wanted to highlight that as a point of connection. The second story that I want to share with you is very close to my heart, because two of my very close friends work there, and this is a congregation in Hendersonville, La Capilla de Santa Maria, and many of our students have done service work there. Some of our students go there. If we're going to do a study abroad in a Spanish-speaking country, they'll attend services. And so I'm just very appreciative of the role of La Capilla and their partnership with Warren Wilson. I'm going to read just a short excerpt from the chapter in the ministry is Creating Sacred Spaces, Energy Efficiency, Green Jobs, and Green Building. So we're shifting from Milwaukee to Western North Carolina. Carlos Velasquez was the first senior warden to have been deported in the history of the Episcopal Diocese of Western North Carolina. His church, La Capilla de Santa Maria in Hendersonville, North Carolina, ministers to Spanish-speaking immigrants in the mountains of North Carolina. The former lay leader of La Capilla, Carlos was a tall, lean man in his 50s who dressed as if he might meet the president at any time. With impeccable manners, he had a dignified and compassionate air when he knelt down to speak with young children. Carlos was forced to sign a voluntary departure form after applying for and being denied global asylum. The church rallied around him. While most churches in the diocese held bake sales to fund outreach, La Capilla hosted salsa dances and sold raffle tickets for Rosetta Stone and language CDs to offset his legal bills. The women of the church sold tamales in the salon, the drafty modular building that serves as the congregation's parish hall. It cost the state community a lot of money when Carlos was forced to leave, said Jill Rios, former director of the religious environmental organization North Carolina Interfaith Power and Light and wife of La Capilla's priests. How do you build financial sustainability in a faith community of intergenerational poverty and a broken immigration system? For several months, the fundraising of this small church went almost exclusively toward expenses for Carlos, a church member in crisis. La Capilla itself was a community in crisis, whose members struggled to pay their bills, avoid deportation, and support family members both in the United States and in their home countries. For this church as an institution, sustainability meant the ability to pay the utility bills, which constitute 20% of the church's budget. For La Capilla, green building and energy efficiency provided an avenue for increasing the financial sustainability of its sacred spaces while promoting green jobs and enhancing the connection of its members to God's creation in their new home in Western North Carolina. La Capilla is situated on an oasis of 15 acres of wooded land just off the highways and sprawls of Hendersonville. The mobile home served as a parish hall used electric baseboard heat and provided space for weekly classes, Bible study, guitar lessons, and social gatherings. One evening at La Capilla, during the winter, someone turned on the electric heat in the salon and forgot to turn it off. The heat ran all week, resulting in $500 of additional cost, the equivalent of a month's collection of revenues from the collection plate. A simple mistake like leaving on the thermostat shouldn't kill the community, said Reverend Austin Rios. A large part of the work of churches happens in the buildings, the sanctuaries and parish halls that surround Christians when they pray, grieve, eat, and celebrate God's world. And a significant proportion of the revenues goes to maintaining the facilities where people gather so they can do God's work outside of the church. Each physical structure in a congregation demands resources, and our consumption and conservation of those resources reflect our religious beliefs in God. La Capilla started thinking about energy efficiency because energy costs were the biggest expense for this mission congregation. It seemed like the best idea was to tie what we care about, creation, with our biggest cost, energy, said Austin. Despite financial challenges, the parishioners at La Capilla brought the richness of their home traditions and cultures to the liturgy, including music and services in Spanish, and celebrations of the Day of the Dead. This outdoor procession and worship service features sparkling lights and prayer flags hanging in the night to honor family members who have died, especially those who died crossing the border. The sanctuary at La Capilla represents a safe and sacred place for parishioners with connections to both their past and their present. As Jill often said, this is where I feel closest to God. With the growing Latino population in Western North Carolina, the viability of this ministry is connected to its finances and thus to energy efficiency. Well, I want to show you some of the images from from Montevideo. And I'm excited, I actually just talked to Jill yesterday, as well as to Philip Gibson of the Environmental Leadership Center, and they're starting to talk about the possible collaboration of La Capilla with Project Insulate, one of our weatherizing outreach programs. So I'm really excited for the next chapter. Excited about that. Tying what we care about, creation, with the biggest cost is a real take-home message for congregations. So we need some help, so I'm doing something wrong.
Just hold it down lower.
Hold it down lower. Okay, that's what I'm not doing. So the sanctuary at La Capilla was built in 1923. And when I was doing the research for this chapter, one of the projects that I was documenting was the building of a cob oven. It included a lot of participation with Warren Wilson students. This was, it's become kind of a joke, I have to tell you, because everything I've written since the publication of the book, I talk about the cob oven. My sister has even said, can you stop talking about the cob oven? But for me, it's a real metaphor, because this was a project that was built from resources of the property, of the church property. Cob is a combination of clay, sand, and straw. And this oven was built, it was an intergenerational project. There were kids working on this project. There were teenagers in high heels. There were senior citizens. And so, and also one of my students interned with La Capilla, Amy Wachowski, to help organize this process. That's what I was doing wrong. This image just captures to me the immediacy of natural building, actually getting your feet in the mud to create something. And again, this was the old folks, the young folks were all there together. We worked with Tony Furskins, and Jill made this contact, a natural builder in Nashville. And he did not speak Spanish, but Jill and Austin both interpreted for him. And it was wonderful seeing this combination of language and different ages and skills. The parishioners were gaining skills in green building techniques. And the idea was not just to build a cob oven to make pizza, that was one of the goals in breads, but also to build green building skills and create a micro enterprise for the church. And people were really proud of the process. That was fun to get to document that and be a part of it. Another student, Phil Hamilton, also interned at La Capilla, and his goal was to take the first steps to creating a garden with vegetables from the church that could be used on these pieces. So it was just neat to see a project like that that included so much collaboration from Warren Wilson, as well as connecting our students with a serious, serious issue of the impacts of immigration here and on folks who have immigrated here. It's the issues of justice are so intrinsically linked with environmental issues, and to have that for our students, to get to have that exposure and to see, you could stay here in Warren Wilson and not know what's happening. We could be stopped at a checkpoint, but not realize the implications of that for our people, our brothers and sisters that are right here in our neighbors. I'd like to share with you a few words from the conclusion, which summarizes some of the impact on me, as well as the take-home messages from the stories I collected. The conclusion's entitled, Acts of Faith Transformed by Grace. The Reverend Kennedy McGowan of First Presbyterian Church in Hollywood, Florida, called it a God Day. He used this phrase to describe his congregation's work with a coalition of Immokalee workers in the Burger King boycott. At some point, the work gained a momentum greater than any individual efforts, resulting in agreements from fast food companies to increase wages for farm workers. The saints described in this book led ordinary lives touched by both passion and grace. They worked for God's good earth by connecting people with places. They were grounded in a place. Their work mattered to both spiritual and ecological communities. And they continued this work even in the face of seemingly insurmountable challenges like corporate spying or large-scale industrial pollution. The people I met in places as diverse as the tomato fields of South Florida and the urban streets of downtown Newark often emphasize the same themes for the religious environmental movement. Some of those themes were to emphasize the hope that comes from a perspective of faith, integrate prayer and ritual into the environmental movement, create partnerships with other groups doing environmental work, focus on justice, bear witness to the power of stories, and integrate creation into worship, outreach, and education. As a witness to these stories and strategies, I began to identify these lessons in my own life. One poignant lesson embodies the power of hope, intention, and individual acts that can transform our connection with God and the earth. 2 years before my father's unexpected and sudden death, he outlined on a single piece of paper his plans for what some would call an environmentally sustainable burial. But he didn't use the word green or environment. However, he communicated his wishes for a funeral that relied on family and friends and not a funeral home. As his grown children, we later followed his wishes, wrapping his body in white linen tablecloths, asking his close friend to build a pine casket, using a pickup truck to transport his casket to the church, shoveling dirt on top of the grave, and singing gospel tunes like I'll Fly Away while his bluegrass band played in the background. One definition of a saint is someone whose story God is telling. The stories God revealed during this research showed me that my father performed a radical religious act by planning his own homegrown funeral. This God thing has the power to convert our individual radical acts of faith into a collective force which is necessary to confront the environmental degradation we face. Our hopeful acts are bold and diverse. One funeral planned, one loaf of communion bread baked, one church garden tilled, one solar panel installed, one cup oven built. Together we represent a communion of saints deeply rooted in God's good earth, but moving forward one step at a time. So with that, I want to close by just a few words about reading these stories in places across the United States just in the past couple months, and writing about stories that are continuing. First of all, after I wrote the book, as I said, I thought I was done. But my best friend from high school, you'll recall the person whose birthday I forgot. Well, she is a marketing guru, has picked potatoes in high school, but now hangs out with Bill Gates. We both thought we could change the world. She's making money. I'm very happy here. So she called me up and she realized, you're not done with your work, friend. She told me, you've got to write about what people are thinking about right now. You have to put your book in some context. So this was last summer. At the time, we were watching the Gulf oil spill destroy the Alabama Gulf Coast, where I'm from. And every year I make a pilgrimage home on the 4th of July. So I went home to Fairhope, Alabama, and I interviewed church leaders who were organizing interfaith prayer vigils. And I wrote about it. And then I later wrote op-eds about issues like the defeat of the climate bill in the Senate. And I learned a few things. First of all, I learned that if you write about God and climate change in major U.S. newspapers, you will get a response. That's not a problem. And sometimes the response is extreme. But I learned something else. More importantly, I learned that when we respond to the world's uncertainties from a spiritual place, we draw on our similarities and our vulnerabilities as humans. I got a phone call from Mitch Hescox, who is the president of the Evangelical Environmental Network. He's a pretty big guy in Evangelical Environmental Network circles. He had walked from Louisiana to Mississippi and prayed in the summer with folks about the oil spill. So he called me because he'd seen an op-ed in the Charlotte newspaper. And here's the thing, I was so thrilled to get a call from him first. but we talked on the phone for an hour. And after I hung up the phone, I thought, okay, wait a minute. We didn't talk about abortion. We didn't talk about gay marriage. We didn't talk about any of the issues that politicize faith traditions and for which in the media we're kind of known for this divisiveness. We talked about care of creation and what we were doing and what we were writing about. And she's going to contribute a chapter to a book I'm doing now on churches and climate change. When a national evangelical leader and an Episcopalian at a school like Warren Wilson College can share such common ground, that's powerful. And I would go so far as to say it's transformative. Our belief that we must love our neighbors as ourselves can take us out of our political and personal bubbles to connect with people who may not be our Facebook friends. Every great social movement in this country, from the anti-slavery movement to civil rights movement, included the power of religion as a force in transformation. And this movement can be no different. My priest and close friend, Brian Cole, used to work for the environmental leadership, and he often ends services at the Cathedral of All Souls with these words, which I'd like to use tonight in closing. The world is now too dangerous and too beautiful a place for anything but love. Amen.
How related do you think feel spirituality is a way to organic farming, like kind of like the agrarianism.
So how related is spirituality to organic farming?
Yeah.
Well, have you read, I'm just, I assume you've read Wendell Berry?
Okay,
well, you use agrarianism with such savvy that I
assume. My good point.
Okay, well, I would, first of all, I didn't want to make an assumption, but your use of that term makes me, wants me to suggest reading Wendell Berry to help you make those connections, because to me, there's so many good writers out there today that are connecting religious beliefs to farming. Norman Wirzba is another person at Duke University who his theme is God is a gardener. And that's what he writes about. God is a gardener. And really, if you think about how in the Bible how people were created, it's from soil. So there's strong connections, and I'd be glad to, if you want to email me, I'd be glad to send you some specific text that would help you make that connection.
Thank you.
Would you say a further word about your next book?
Sure, I would. Jim's been such a loyal supporter too. I'd be glad to. I'm doing an edited book with New Society Publishers on churches and climate change. And if anybody knows New Society Publishers, they're well known for their environmental works. And they're really excited to get on board with a book that connects faith with climate change. So they are very enthusiastic about this book, and Jill Rios of Lakapia is contributing a chapter. Brian Cole is as well as Norman Wirzba at Duke. Sally Bingham out in California with the Regeneration Project in North Carolina, and Interfaith Power and Light at the national level. So that's what I'm working on right now.
I want to thank all of you for coming tonight and let you know that we're selling copies of Natural Saint out in the lobby, and there will be a book signing. So if you'd like to pick up a copy and get going with that copy and with whatever you plan to do after this talk tonight, we invite you to go out there now. Mallory will be signing books in the parlor off the main room.
I think I'm going to be right here in the foyer.
Are you? Okay, great. Thank you so much.